Happy Labor Day, everybody, and this is the Let's Talk About Pop Music for summer of 2021. One trend that I've noticed over the past few years is that it used to be all the new stuff was released during the summer, but now it's the opposite. All the new stuff is being released during the winter, and the summers have been pretty stagnant for the past few years. That definitely applies this year. I really had to stretch to get 8 songs to even talk about. But nonetheless, let's just jump into it. For some reason, the Kid Laroi keeps making songs that I like. Without You is a guilty pleasure for me, but I will fully defend Stay. I would go as far to say it's one of the best hits of the year. There's just something about the Kid Laroi that has clicked with me for these 2 songs. He might not be very good at singing or writing songs, but he throws himself in every performance I've heard from him. He has enough energy that Justin Bieber, instead of going on autopilot like he normally does on his guest verses, he actually has to sound like he's awake and going and energized to match. The composition of the music is really well done. There is this palpable tension here. You can really feel the desperation in this song. They say that they want this, I assume, woman to stay, and I believe them. And how could she leave when they're making such a compelling argument? Yeah, to be honest, the lyrics are kind of self-defeating. If anything, this is a list of reasons why she should leave. But just like in Without You, I can appreciate the fact that this song isn't putting up any sort of front at all. This is written by someone who is really upset, not very mature, and doesn't know how to process his feelings. And I can relate to that. I'm sure a lot of us can, whether we're thinking about how we used to be or how we are now. It's weird because, according to everything I've heard from the Kid Laroi, I should not like his music, yet here we are. So I guess, good job, Kid Laroi. Your tactics confuse and frighten me. I'd say for a pretty large number of artists, there comes a time when they feel the need to take their biggest hit and try to make it again. The length of time between the original and the remake can vary wildly, but here we kind of see it happening with Doja Cat. Now, I'm not gonna say that Kiss Me More is just a blatant rehash of Say So. We got a much more blatant retread coming up, but I can definitely see the connections. And while I was never crazy for Say So, I can definitely say that this is an inferior version. Some of the things that they added make no sense to me, like the yelling in the background, which is giving me serious Hollaback Girl flashbacks, and that weird, like, rising synth sound that happens every so often. It's just so weird and bad, it's almost gross in a way. The production overall just isn't as tight and meticulous as Say So was. And then we also have SZA, which I would say is the biggest difference between this song and Say So. While she's definitely trying more than Nicki Minaj did on the Say So remix, I don't really like SZA's contribution all that much. As a standard for her, I can't understand half of what she's saying. A lot of time hearing SZA sing makes me think I'm looking at that name one thing in this picture meme. Like, I question whether I even understand English for a few seconds. It's not even an accent or a dialect or anything, she just doesn't enunciate. Overall, this seems more like a rough draft of Say So than like an actually improved sequel to it. Not a huge fan. I really don't understand why bro country is a thing. Like, why do we need this? And even more pressing, why is this having crossover success? The subgenre has been dominated by people like Sam Hunt and Luke Bryan, but Walker Hayes, who is new to me, has thrown his hat in the ring, and wow did he come out swinging with this song. I have not felt this way about a country song since at least Body Like a Back Road. It doesn't fail as a concept as much as that song did, but the execution, something about his tone of voice just sounds so smug to me. Normally, songs like this are framed like, we don't need to have a lot of money in order to have a good time as long as we have each other, but with that smug tone, it doesn't really come off that way here. The chorus especially to this song is just so skeezy, I don't like listening to it. Also, I've worked at Applebee's, that place is not fancy. You should've gone with like, I don't know, Cheesecake Factory or Outback Steakhouse or something. I'm pretty sure that this isn't a song that's meant to be taken all that seriously, and I mean, I guess I can kind of see the appeal, but that appeal is completely lost on me. Thumbs down. No thank you. I'd kind of forgotten the fact that we hadn't heard from Ed Sheeran in a while when I heard this song. And when I actually listened to it, I was underwhelmed. Apparently, a lot of critics have been comparing it to recent songs by The Weeknd, which I kind of agree, but apparently they're comparing it to Blinding Lights, which, like, how dare you? Like, when I'm thinking of songs this makes me think of, Blinding Lights isn't even in the top 100. Number one for me is Can't Get You Out of My Head by Kylie Minogue, a song that I think is okay. It's definitely more catchy than this. Ed Sheeran has been such a presence for so many years that a song like this is kind of the worst thing it could be, which is forgettable. And I just looked this up, I completely forgot. He released a song last year called Afterglow, and I forgot about that too. All in all, this is actually kind of reminding me of what happened with Justin Bieber. Like, 2016 was such a huge year for him, and then in 2020, he's kind of struggling to get back up to where he once was, and honestly just shifted over 1 year, and the same sort of thing is happening with Ed Sheeran. I'm not writing it off completely. I mean, this isn't even nearly as bad or confusing as Yummy, but this is not the best start for his new album cycle. Let's hope he has some better things in store. This isn't the blatantly obvious rehash song I was talking about, but when listening to Butter, it really just kind of sounds like Dynamite 2 to me. But whereas Kiss Me More kind of fell short, I would say that Butter achieved exactly the same thing that Dynamite did, at least to me. They are both perfectly serviceable pop songs. I mean, they're fun, bouncy, catchy enough. I don't really think either song is anything spectacular, but they're not bad. There are some of those songs that don't really get better or worse with repeated listens. They're just sort of there, and they're fine. It just occurred to me that it might sound like I'm trying to walk on eggshells in order to not anger the K-pop stans, but that really does just sum up how I feel about Butter and Dynamite. K-pop in general is just sort of a genre that I appreciate from a distance. And there's not really much else to say about it, so next song. You know, it's kind of impressive in a way. I keep thinking that Maroon 5 has created the most boring, low-effort song possible, and they've proven me wrong at least 3 times by now. At first I thought it was Don't Wanna Know, then it was Girls Like You, then it was Memories, and now we have Beautiful Mistakes. And I think we've gone past the point where it doesn't even sound like they're trying to make good music. Now it doesn't even sound like they're trying to make original music, because this is just Girls Like You, The Revenge. I mean, songs like Kiss Me More and Butter drew inspiration from previous hits, but this is just Girls Like You with a new, worse coat of paint. And Girls Like You wasn't even a very good song to begin with. But at least that song had a decent guitar riff and a pretty good guest verse by Cardi B. But in this song, I mean, I'm not gonna say that Megan Thee Stallion has a bad verse. She's okay, I guess, but she's not really given that much to work with. I mean, there are a couple decent moments in her verse, but overall, it's the best part of the song, mostly just because it's not Adam Levine sounding like he is actually dead. His parts are just so droning and repetitive. But you know what the worst part about this song is? Even despite everything I just said, it is so damn catchy. It has been stuck in my head for like 2 weeks and I hate it. The fact that Maroon 5 can try so little and yet still occupy space in my brain is both infuriating and kind of impressive. It reminds me of that quote from Jaws. Maroon 5 is a perfect engine, a hit-making machine. It's really a miracle of evolution. All this machine does is sleep and breathe and make little hooks, and that's all. Maroon 5 has just been so boring for so long. Like, if you had told me that they had been replaced by, like, a robot at somewhere around 2016, I would have believed you easily. This song is the ultimate conclusion of Maroon 5's career. It's not their most annoying song, but still, I just hate everything about it. So I guess this is what happens when Lil Nas X tries to make a more standard rap song. It doesn't work. I've said this already, but I feel like Lil Nas X really thrives when there's sort of a gimmick in the song, you know, something about it that sets it apart. But when I heard this for the first time, the first thing I thought of was just how much it sounds like Middle Child by J. Cole. Like, even the titles are very similar. I've also said previously that at this point Lil Nas X doesn't seem like a musician per se, as much as a really good salesman, someone who really knows how to play the system, work in the industry, and this song is kind of him flaunting that. We also got Jack Harlow on this song. I didn't like him in What's Poppin', and I like him even less here. Even if you don't like Lil Nas X, normally he's at least interesting, but I can't say that about him in Industry Baby. Like a lot of other songs from this summer, there's not really much I have to say about it, so next. When I talked about Bang by AJR, I said that it was sort of paving the way for songs like it to get crossover success, and this was a song that actually did do that. I've known about Heat Waves by Glass Animals for, I'm pretty sure, over a year at this point. And it became a sleeper hit, even ending up in the top 20. I actually had pretty low expectations for this song, because before that I had heard Your Love by them, which I didn't like even a little, but this was a pleasant surprise. This is definitely a song that I've marinated and listened to for a while. And over time, I've come to appreciate just how much was put into it. Like, even now, like today, when I was listening to it with headphones, I kept hearing little touches that they put in, like little things that they added to make it more interesting. The harmonies are really nice, they keep changing up the percussion so it's not that repetitive. Overall, it's very relaxing and mellow, but there also is like a rise and a fall to it. This type of song is not normally my thing. I like it when songs feel really big and sweeping and powerful, but there is a time and place for songs like Heat Waves. I mean, it's not the best thing ever. I can think of about a dozen other alternative songs that I would have rather have gotten crossover success, but if we had to have one, this isn't a bad choice. Overall, Heat Waves is a very good summer song. It just took us until the following summer to realize that. And that's the video. I am planning to do 31 Horror Nights for 2021, so stay tuned for that. I'll see you guys later.